Welcome back to Season 2 of 12 Days in March. In this section, we'll continue our approach to undifferentiated symptoms, focusing on chest pain and the anginal syndromes. Myocardial infarction and derivatives will be covered in a separate recording. The test writers in Philadelphia have only a limited and predictable amount of mischief they can generate on this topic. The major issues and derivatives are pretty well flushed out in this presentation. As with other recordings, a PDF is available at the 12 Days website. So let's begin. Although we'll focus on the anginal syndromes, the USMLE vignettes don't present patients with angina. They present patients with chest pain. It is up to you to bring it home. So how will you know? Before digging into that brief differential of chest pain, let's clarify the difference between an MI and angina. These are distinguished by the EKG and cardiac biomarkers, with an emphasis on the biomarkers. As you will learn shortly, ST segments can be transiently depressed or elevated during the cardiac hypoperfusion associated with anginal syndromes. It is the elevation of biomarkers, including troponin or CPK, that distinguishes hypoperfusion from frank myocardial injury. So how will we know when we are dealing with angina and not some other cause of chest pain? The NBME keeps this pretty straightforward. Generally speaking, cardiac angina will be described by the typical descriptors of tightness, squeezing, heaviness, or pressure. They will use this description to direct you to the three anginal syndromes we'll be discussing today. These are chronic stable angina, characterized by exertional chest pain that is relieved by rest. This symptom comes on during periods of increased myocardial oxygen demand, such as walking up a hill. Unstable angina, also classified as an acute coronary syndrome, may have onset with activity, but it is not relieved by rest, or it may simply be described with onset at rest. Unlike stable angina, which is associated with an increased oxygen demand, unstable angina is caused by a decrease in coronary blood flow. And the third syndrome is vasospastic angina, also referred to as variant or Prinzmetal's angina. This syndrome is non-exertional, and as if to underscore the non-exertional nature, it frequently comes on nocturnally. You can't get more non-exertional than that. So these are the three anginal syndromes which you need to be familiar with and we'll explore in some detail. And just to compare and contrast, as previously suggested, patients experiencing myocardial infarction will also have typical anginal symptoms, but the MI patient will be described with associated EKG changes and elevation of biomarkers. MI will be reviewed in a separate video, but generally speaking, the NBME uses the diagnosis of MI for a number of other key derivatives with a focus on pathology and myocardial cell injury. The point is that you won't struggle identifying a patient with chest pain as having an MI. It won't be subtle. So again, the patient with angina will have pretty typical symptoms, but you will need to consider the other important chest pain syndromes. I will briefly review those which are most likely to be encountered during step one. So here are the biggies. Diseases of the pericardium, covered in a separate video, is characterized by sharp and positional chest pain. In step one vignettes, these patients are almost always described as refusing to lie back. The setting is usually acute pericarditis, and a friction rub is typically described. Pulmonary disorders may present with chest pain, with the chief among these being the pleuritic chest pain associated with pulmonary embolism, or the sudden onset of chest pain associated with pneumothorax. PE has been discussed in the video on pulmonary vascular disorders, and pneumothorax was discussed in the video on diseases of the pleura. But since I did have a patient present with a spontaneous pneumothorax this week, I'll include her chest x-ray and reiterate that questions on pneumothorax almost always include some mention of decreased breath sounds, hyperresonance to percussion, and in this instance, a trachea that was maintained in the midline. The pneumothorax itself might be described by a linear radiolucency noted on chest x-ray and is pretty well demonstrated on this film. You can also see on this x-ray the characteristic appearance of a patient with the spontaneous rupture of an apical bleb, long and lean. The other chest pain vignettes you are likely to encounter include aortic dissection, which will be described by a ripping or tearing sensation. Asymmetric pulses are frequently present. And finally, mitral valve prolapse. Although a click should be described, this is not always the case. These patients may only be described as being young with associated palpitations. The chest pain and mitral valve prolapse is simply an association. They are not mechanistically related. As you can appreciate, these chest pain syndromes are very distinct and unique compared with the patient who experiences angina. When they do present any of the modifiers just described, such as pleuritic chest pain, the NBME is specifically telling you the patient does not have coronary artery disease or angina as the etiology. Please pay attention to these clues. They are included for a reason. For completeness, I'm listing the other favorite chest pain scenarios used by the writers in Philadelphia. The asthmatic patient might be described with chest pain, but they will generally be young and wheezing. Musculoskeletal pain, such as costochondritis, can have chest pain, but these don't make for great questions. Diseases of the esophagus, such as G-reflux disease and esophageal spasm, will present with chest pain, but the questions quickly differentiate into associated GI symptomatology, as occurs with hepatobiliary and pancreatic disorders as well. And finally, chest pain is an important symptom of aortic stenosis, but they have other derivatives to test you on with that disorder. Not to digress, but SVT or other tachyarrhythmias such as fast AFib can present with demand ischemia and chest pain, but these scenarios will be obvious. Do be aware that adenosine, used to treat SVT, can cause chest pain and flushing as a typical adverse effect. In those vignettes, the presence of chest pain will be your key to determining, quote-unquote, the agent used to terminate the arrhythmia. Specifically, you will be shown a graphic, such as the one shown here demonstrating SVT. They will use language such as, a medicine was used to terminate the rhythm disturbance shown on this graphic. That medicine caused chest pain and or flushing. What was the medication? Or more likely the mechanism of action of that medication. Chest pain and flushing will be your clinical clues. Having covered the broad differential of the chest pain disorders you are most likely to encounter on the boards, let's turn our attention to the anginal syndromes. As noted earlier, the history will be a key component in identifying the correct syndrome. The distinction between pain relieved with rest and either non-exertional or pain not relieved by rest is very vital language to the correct categorization of your patient. You need to completely understand this difference because this will be the language that sets up the question derivatives. The patient with stable angina, that is, pain relieved by rest, is a patient who has obstructive or occlusive coronary disease. These are flow-limiting lesions, as we'll review. The patient with unstable angina has an underlying atherosclerotic lesion, but now has a superimposed partially occluding thrombus. And the patient with vasospastic angina, by definition, cannot have any evidence of obstructive disease. They may have some atherosclerosis, but, by definition, it cannot be flow-limiting. Insofar as the pathophysiology, in the patient with stable angina and coronary obstruction, the flow-limiting occlusion becomes symptomatic during periods of increased oxygen demand. Mechanistically, this differs from unstable angina, which is associated with plaque rupture and thrombus. The patient with stable angina has neither of these characteristics. Viewing this graphic with a tight proximal LAD stenosis makes it easy to envision the concept of flow limitation. One of the key derivatives you must be familiar with is the impact of that flow limitation. Since our stenoses are located in the epicardial vessels, which is the point most distant from that occlusion? Answer, the subendocardium. And here is a graphic depiction of flow from the epicardial vessels deep into the subendocardium. In obstructive coronary disease, flow to the subendocardium becomes compromised. One of the potential complications of chronic hypoperfusion is impairment of LV function, represented here by cardiomegaly on chest x-ray, just to emphasize the point. The compromised LV function is engendered by the concept of the hibernating myocardium. If they are going to test you on a hibernating heart, chronic angina will be the context. Hibernation is defined by impaired LV function due to chronically reduced blood flow, as can be seen in patients with obstructive coronary disease. The importance of hibernating myocardium, as opposed to infarcted tissue, is the potential reversibility with restoration of blood flow. Compare and contrast hibernation with another term you're apt to encounter called stunned myocardium. Both hibernation and myocardial stunning are characterized by impaired LV function and reduced coronary blood flow, but stunning refers to myocardial impairment seen during acute vessel occlusion. If a vessel is acutely occluded, reduction in LV function may be demonstrated in the absence of myocardial cell injury. The myocardium is literally stunned. So stunning is a term generally associated with acute coronary occlusion, whereas hibernating myocardium refers to the state of chronic occlusion. I would consider this to be low-yield information, or information reserved for hard questions, but there is no reason to give this concept away. Insofar as key pathophysiology in the patient with unstable angina, the buzz phrase is rupture of the vulnerable plaque with development of a partially occluding thrombus. We'll cover vulnerable plaques during our discussion of atherosclerosis, but for purposes of this discussion, and MI for that matter, you should be familiar with one of the key mediators of plaque rupture, macrophage-derived metalloproteinases. For all intents and purposes, you can picture these enzymes as destabilizing the extracellular matrix. With plaque rupture comes release of thrombogenic substances that precipitate localized clot development. So I've mentioned the key derivative of a partially occlusive thrombus several times, but how will you identify it as partially occlusive? Do you ask the patient if you could rip out one of their coronary vessels? No. Patients don't generally like that approach. We know it is only partially occlusive when the vignette reports ST segment depression but normal biomarkers. The ST segment identifies hypoperfusion, but the biomarker excludes cellular injury. So we've covered the key pathophysiologic derivatives of stable and unstable angina. What about vasospastic disease? Pretty straightforward. We have vascular smooth muscle hyperreactivity. Although mediators such as thromboxane A2 and endothelin are suggested, there isn't a direct cause and effect here. I list those mostly to remind you these are known vasoconstrictors, and vasoconstriction is the pathophysiologic mechanism. You just need to be familiar with the notion of reactive segments in the coronary vessels. Interestingly, vasospastic disease is characterized by elevation of the ST segments, and these can be captured on ambulatory EKG monitoring. Although I've made the point of negative biomarkers in angina versus infarction, in patients with protracted vasospasm, myocardial injury may be seen, so elevation of biomarkers in these patients might be reported. However, the hallmark of these patients is the absence of occlusive disease. This information will be reported with either a negative stress test or angiogram. So if a patient has nocturnal chest pain and is reported with ST segment elevation and minor elevation of biomarkers, and they want you to choose vasospastic disease, they will need to prove to you the absence of occlusion. I am making this point because I don't want you to get thrown by elevation of biomarkers in a patient with variant angina. So let's review testing, and I'll start with vasospastic disease to finish up the concept just mentioned. Two pieces of data will be presented in the patient with vasospastic angina. The first is lack of flow-limiting occlusion, as just mentioned. This will be reflected either by a negative stress test or clean vessels on arteriography. The second way they come after you is with provocative testing, and specifically with the administration of a vasoconstricting agent. On USMLE, the vasoconstricting agent of choice is ergonovine. Ergonovine is an alpha agonist that elicits vasospasm in reactive segments of the coronary vessels. So let's circle back to stable angina. We know the patient has occlusive disease, but how will these be demonstrated? A stress test might be described with ST segment changes during exercise that resolve during the recovery period. Alternatively, they may offer you angiographic findings of the flow-limiting lesion. More often, however, they will describe the scenario of a patient with stable angina and ask you to correlate with the angiographic finding, including an obstructive lesion of at least 70%. The patient with unstable angina will typically be described with ST segment depressions and normal biomarkers. Although we'll get to typical questions shortly, be aware that a patient with chronic stable angina can be described who evolves into a patient with unstable angina. The typical question will be a patient with a previous pattern of stable exertional chest pain, now having pain at rest. The derivative question will follow about plaque rupture and/or development of partially occluding thrombus. And finally, before reviewing some questions, just a brief word on pharmacotherapy. Detailed discussion of these agents await the pharmacology videos, but I want to emphasize the importance of being familiar with nitrates and specifically the physiologic mechanism by which they are used as anti-anginals. Whereas nitrates are considered vasodilators, they preferentially dilate large veins. Think of them as venodilators. The result of dilating large veins is a decrease in preload, also described by end-diastolic volume. In so doing, they decrease myocardial oxygen demand. This is the mechanism by which they are used as antianginals, period, end of story. Whereas they do cause some dilation of the coronary vessels, this is an insignificant function, and the sooner you divorce this concept, the better. Dilation of large veins with reduction in preload should be etched in your mind's eye. I love that eye. It's hypnotizing. like my lectures. Insofar as coronary vasospasm, just be aware that calcium channel blockers are the treatment of choice. Any within the class may be used. On the boards, there are only a limited number of questions where you expected to know a specific treatment. This is one of them. And that concludes the content section of this presentation. On the next few slides, we'll review typical questions on the anginal syndromes, and then we're out of here. So a typical question on stable angina will be pretty straightforward. You will be asked to correlate the symptom of exertional chest pain relieved by rest with the degree of vessel occlusion. They will want you to know the subendocardium is hypoperfused. They can certainly query you with a scenario on hibernating myocardium, as in the second question. Your choices will boil down to hibernation versus stunning. And finally, as previously reviewed, you must be familiar with the mechanism of action of nitrates and the mechanism by which they achieve symptom relief. This slide includes the answers to those questions. Typical questions for unstable angina would include a description, such as a patient with a history of exertional chest pain relieved with rest, now experiencing pain at rest. EKG during the episode reveals transient ST segment depressions. Troponin is not detected in the serum. They'll ask you to describe his syndrome, and the test options are listed. They'll query the precipitating event, focusing on plaque rupture and or the pathologic lesion of a partially obstructing clot. And here the answers are provided for you. And finally, the typical scenarios on vasospasm. Nocturnal chest pain with abnormal EKG. In this scenario, the troponin is slightly elevated, but they go on to describe the absence of obstructive disease. What's his diagnosis? Vasospasm, or variant, or Prinz metals. They are one and the same. They can ask about the provocative drug used during testing, or its mechanism of action. And finally, they'll query the treatment of choice. And here are the answers to those questions. I've included index card summaries of the materials just covered. I do encourage students to take less notes, not more. And they always ask the follow-up question, what is the material I need to know? This is summarized on the next three slides for your convenience. Chronic stable angina, unstable angina, also categorized as acute coronary syndrome, and vasospastic angina. The anginal syndromes have a very finite curriculum reviewed in this presentation. There is no reason to miss any of these questions. If you have any questions on this or any of the material covered in 12 Days videos, please email me at 12 Days in March. Thank you.